Jadi bersama kita pada pagi ini, kita bersama dengan tetamu kita, seorang perancang kewangan bersama dengan Yong Shih Ching ya, daripada FPAB sebenarnya. Very good morning, selamat pagi.
Hello, good morning, selamat pagi.
How was your Hari Raya? I mean together amongst bersama dengan kita kaum Melayu. Ada apa ni buat kunjungan berhari raya?
Ada, but then recently saya punya anak baru lahir, oh. So very busy lah.
Okay.
No time to celebrate too much lah, but the raya is a good time.
Oh, okay. Now this will be really interesting. Ini akan cukup menarik sebab kita ni akan bercakap tentang perancangan kewangan.
Yeah.
Mungkin Yong sendiri dapat mengongsikan pengalaman peribadi kerana seperti mana yang kita katakan, mungkin dengan menjelangnya perayaan-perayaan ya, jadi memerlukan perancangan-perancangan tergantung anu. Dan menarik sekali disebabkan Yong sendiri baru menimang cahaya mata. How was your financial preparation untuk memprepare menerima keluarga ahli baru keluarga ya. Baru? Karena mungkin akan ada beberapa di kalangan penonton akan menerima kehadiran anak ataupun orang ahli keluarga yang baru.
Yeah, well to be honest, it's very chaotic lah. I think like any new changes in the lifestyle, it was very chaotic. But at the same time, we kind of expected that it will be this way already lah. So in terms of financial planning for the baby, actually I already did the planning beforehand. So I was actually expecting like how much is the cost and what do I actually have to prepare for my son in this case, on what do I aspire him to be. So which I'm actually going to go through later on the steps that I did for myself to welcome my newest.
Dan mungkin secara umumnya in general the steps can be used. Sama ada mungkin preparation for Idul Fitri, open house dan sebagainya. Just a quick question before that. Anak mana lebih mahal? Anak lelaki nak beli bini?
Oh, that one I don't know. But I think for bini-bini should be more expensive lah. Have more accessories. You buy more baju. The boy, you buy one, then you wear 7 days kan.
Habis.
Alright, okay. So maybe seperti mana saya katakan, mungkin step-step tertentu ya. Macam contohnya kalau okay, hari raya. Kita ni kan membuat open house contohnya, ataupun sebelum itu mungkin difikirkan boleh ke kita ni membuat open house, kalau if we can, macam mana preparationnya, and how do we know whether we can we cannot, sama ada kita ni boleh membuka open house ataupun tidak, dan macam mana meriahnya sesuatu perayaan itu tergantung dengan kita ni punya kewangan.
Okay, I think the first question you have to ask yourself when you want to open house kan, is to ask what is the intention lah. Why do I want to actually have an open house? Is it to meet up with my saudara-saudara, or I want to hang out with my friends? That's okay. So then you actually look into your finances. Can I mampu to actually hold this? So that's where you look into the cost, like how much is it for the makanan? How much would it be to actually how many people am I inviting? Yeah. So all this will be add up the cost, and then you see at the end of the day whether it's feasible or not. Yeah. But then the topic today we're going to talk about is more in lifetime general, rather than one specific event. We're looking at the big thing, which is like I want to retire. Oh. I want to buy a house 10 years later. So I want to own a car at the same time, and I want to actually look into my legacy planning, all these things. So we're looking at one big picture, and then we zoom down to each individual ones, rather than a very specific event I want to do. But of course, for financial planning, you can also include those specific events into your financial plan as well. Yeah. Like for example, my son when he was born. So that was actually part of my financial planning to make sure that he is okay lah when he was born, or I have enough to prepare for him.
Okay, jadi artinya dalam kita ni membuat lifetime planning. Jadi adakah kalau dalam social media, we know that contohnya Facebook ada timeline, tapi timelinenya ke belakang. A lot of people don't do a 10 year, 20, 30 years timeline ahead, ke depan. Jadi maybe how can ataupun how would you advise bagaimana Yong boleh menasihatkan kita ni untuk memulakan apa ni perancangan timeline ke hadapan?
Okay, so I think we have a 6-step process in terms of perancangan kewangan on how to actually get yourself started. The first step is we call it the establishing your goals. So this actually to me is the most important step. Pasal this is the one that is setting the direction on what do I actually want to do or why do I even want to spend time to sit down and think about all these things? Is it going to be beneficial to me in the future? So during this stage, for us, when we work with our clients, we are going to ask them on like what are their thoughts on how's your savings, how's your investments, do you do any insurance, do you have any debts or many more things, and also to find out the goals that you want to achieve, the big goals you want to achieve like 5 years, 10 years or 20 years down the road lah. That's where we go into number two, which is after understanding what do I want to achieve, then we go into the data. So data meaning what is relevant lah, talking about like, so what is my income? Apa saya punya
pendapatan.
And then what is my expenses also? So how much is my expenses fixed? How much is my expenses? Well, depending on my mood lah. Kalau saya ada entertainment, I do more of it. So the fixed one, you cannot jalan because it's already there. You have to pay like kereta, rumah or anything like that. And then you can look into, do I have any dependents? So dependent meaning someone who needs me to support them financially. If let's say for example my son, he will be my dependent lah. So ada anak-anak or ibu bapa yang retire sudah. So these are my dependents. Anything that will affect my finances will be considered here. So this usually takes quite a while. If you can do it in 10 minutes, actually it's not done properly. It usually takes like half an hour to even 1 hour. Sometimes we even have sessions of 3 hours or more if the situation is a bit more complicated lah, just to actually gather the information.
Jadi Yong telah pun mengungsikan ya, dalam kita ni membuat persiapan dalam kehidupan yang khususnya jangka masa panjang ya, jangka masa 10, 20, 30 tahun. Jadi matlamat dalam jangka masa tersebut perlu ada dan kemudian kita ni perlu membuat mendata ya. Betul. Ataupun menjadikan apa dan data ini harus ditulis ya ataupun disenaraikan. Jadi senaraikan keperluan-keperluannya dan data ini apabila sudah ada data harus dianalisa. Now, what you are sharing is something yang uncommon. Orang dah biasa membuat ni, mendata apa, jangan katakan mendata mengambil data, harta pembelian pun kecuali orang yang mungkin berbisnes kali hanya mengumpul receipt. Kalau orang kita ni biasa mengumpul receipt pun jarang. Jadi macam mana seseorang itu apa ni melihat daripada data? Maybe it is tabulated and then and then what do you see ataupun dilihat data tu? I know kalau di bidang apa ni, kalau di bidang kesihatan, doktor mencek vital signs.
Yes.
I don't know about financial vital signs macam mana.
So actually finance also have this vital signs as well. We look at how's the income versus the expenses, how's the ratio, is it healthy or not? If it's too low, then we actually will look into ways to help you to increase it further lah. For example, let's say young people nowadays, I think lifestyle is a very important emphasis for them. So sometimes it's common for them to splurge too much on the lifestyle. So then that's where we look into it and say if they're willing to, you know, tone it down a bit so that actually they can prepare more for the future. So that's where the analysis actually comes in to help to see all these factors that you have done, the financial bits that you have actually been doing. Can it help you to achieve your financial goal or not? So if you continue to do what you do, you tell me, Ching, I want to retire when I'm 55. If you continue to do this, can you retire at 55? That's actually where we look into it lah. So it's not going to be very complicated if you want to do it yourself. It's very simple. Like if you have extra 500 every month, times it by 12, times it by 30 years when you retire, is it going to achieve your goal? If not, then you have to look into other ways lah. If it can, okay. Tanya lah, you have done your, you can actually retire if you just continue it consistently. Okay, that's where if we see there's something that we cannot help, there's ways that you couldn't achieve it because your goal is either too big or the things you've been doing is not efficient enough. That's where we look into how to develop a plan to help you to achieve that goal. It could be changes to your lifestyle, but of course, unless you're willing to lah. What are the things that you're willing to do to actually achieve it? And then we'll look into, like, is there any investment that you can consider? Is there any savings that you can consider just to make sure that you can achieve your goal or make it faster? Mm. But yeah, but then this step is actually not magical. It's not like, ching, I go through step number four with you, all my goals will be achieved. Usually very jarang lah. Because yeah, there's so much resources limitations, but then we, what we can do is we do it step by step lah.
Okay. Mm. Nah, jadi daripada apa ni informasi ataupun data yang telah pun kita ni senaraikan ya. Jadi kita ni perlu membuat satu perancangan ataupun plan. Now, dari segi mendevelop ataupun melaksanakan sesuatu perancangan plan, can someone plan on their own or should they seek an advice? Adakah seorang itu boleh membuat perancangannya sendiri ataupun lebih baik perancangannya itu dibawa secara konsultasi dengan seseorang?
Okay, if they want to do their own planning, definitely can. 100% doable. But I think just like a doctor, you know, doctor can't really, they are doctors, they know the best, right? But yeah, they still seek other doctors for consultation just to actually get a second opinion. And that's where we actually come in as a second opinion on what you have been doing. Because we see so much people on how they've been doing. Sometimes us individual, we don't see the full picture. Yeah. Because we're really emotionally attached. I said, I must have this BMW. Yeah. You know, so that's where we as financial planner will come to actually ask, like, what does the BMW mean in your life? So how can it help you to achieve your goal? If it does, or if it's a necessary thing, then sure, go ahead. But what are the sacrifices that you are going through by doing so as well? So that's where we analyze all these things as well.
Jadi apa ni, meminta pendapat orang luar juga mempunyai apa ni, ada ia punya impactnya. Nah, step nombor 5 ni yang payah ni, implement, alright. My friend, teman saya ada membagi dua konotasinya, ada dua ninya. Either action ataupun nyorang punya accent, antara dua. Dua-dua sama, action ataupun accent, mana satu?
Sudah menjadi tu.
Jadi implementation partnya macam kita ni sudah plan, tapi to start it off dan menjalankannya cukup susah. Jadi macam mana tu?
Okay, yeah, like you say, it's actually the hardest step to do lah. All the plans quite easy to come up, but it's hard to implement. So I would recommend to start small. You know, if you've been used to saving $50, try 60 or even 70, 80, so something not too much, so you are used to it, and then gradually from there you build up more and more, 100, 200, 300. I have clients who save 1,500 every month, easy, easily. Yeah, but then they also started from something small, also like 100, 200, 300. So, but it's a discipline thing lah. Action is always discipline. You do it one time, easy, but yeah, 2, 3, 4, 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, it's very tough. Yeah, so I think that's the best advice, is to start small first.
And then finally, kadangnya ada orang start tetapi monitoring proses satu yang ndada. So how important kita ni memonitor ataupun kita ni memastikan kita ni on track sebenarnya?
It's very, very important. Actually, number 6, which is the monitoring progress, it's very important because the goals that you set is not one time you set, then you hit. Things will change. Like myself, my family situation changed. With my baby born, my financial goals change as well. My aspirations will not be just for me or my wife, it will be including my son as well. So those are actually important thing, time for me to relook into my finances, because if I just continue to do things right that way, I might neglect actually my son, maybe on the education or future planning in that sense. So especially for maybe if you there's a career change, or there are some lifestyle changes, someone important to you that passed away, or someone that you are dependent on passed away, those are very huge impact and should be monitored or should review your plans, especially if your plans are dependent on them or will affect them in the future.
Okay, just dalam kata ni menyimpulkan, we are now in the middle of the year, and then depending on tertakluk kepada perusahaan-perusahaan tertentu ataupun mungkin di jabatan kerajaan, kita ni ada fiscal year, kita ni membuat fiscal year. Jadi contohnya kalau kita ni berada di pertengahan fiscal year ataupun di hujung fiscal year ataupun mungkin di hujung tahun, kan memulakan tahun baru contohnya, bagaimana kita ni memulakan? Apa ni, should we wait until the next year ataupun if we were to start immediately, bagaimana?
Okay, I think if you want to start immediately now, because that's my title, to start now,
yeah.
You can actually immediately now take out a piece of pen and start writing down what's your financial goals now.
Mm-hmm.
And then you look into, okay, how much is my income? How much is my expenses? So how much is left behind? What am I doing with this money? This money, can it help me to achieve my goal if I just continue to do like either savings or anything? Then you see if there's any shortfall. For example, if I want to retire with 500,000 in my account, so if I continue to do what I do, I will have 100,000. There is a shortfall of 400,000, right? Mm-hmm. So what can I do to actually achieve that 400,000? Yeah. Sometimes not possible, then you adjust your goal. So maybe instead of 500, I change it to 400. Then I adjust my savings and investments mm-hmm. all over again so that I can bring myself closer. But then not saying that, that 500,000 will not be able to achieve forever because mm-hmm. maybe next year there's a promotion.
No.
Or there are, you know, other opportunities coming in. That's where actually the monitoring comes in to actually relook into all these changes so that you can bring to your goal faster.
Hmm, yeah. Okay. Sebenarnya ada lagi beberapa pertanyaan, tapi mungkin di lain kesempatannya. Jadi terima kasih Yong Sheh Cheng ya, yang merupakan perancangan perancang keuangan di Persatuan Perancangan Keuangan Brunei FPAB. And also congratulations for having your new born son.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right.